Camille often accuses me of having sermons before my sermons, and this is no different Sunday. Too much going on in the world before I pray to settle myself down and try and do the sermon notes that I've prepared and that Sydney doesn't even have access to today anyway. But I want to start with tomorrow and work my way back. Tomorrow's Veterans Day, and I stand before you, a pastor, grateful for our servicemen and women, active and retired. And I want to take the opportunity to name and acknowledge the veterans in our midst. There were about 9 in our first service who were able to stand to be recognized. But those who have chosen country and freedom as a way and pattern of life, it's a reminder to me that there are those that, even in the midst of maybe national division on a big scale, there are those who serve you and me with their lives and with their choices. And so I'm grateful on this Veterans Day. So let's start with that piece. Let's just do that. If you are an active or retired service member or reservist, would you please stand so we can see your face in worship and know that you're a part of our prayer? Don, absolutely. There are others. Absolutely. Blessings and thank you for that. I won't have you stand for all the rest of the day. There's other pieces we'll pray for too, but I'll say this. I said this last year. I say it every year. I'm of the strongly held conviction that the best way that we can celebrate and honor our veterans on Veterans Day is to champion the cause of having a robust and functional VA system and employment opportunities for our men and women when they return. We need to honor them and support them as actively in the second phases of their lives as we do when they are abroad or serving us in this nation. The mental health issues that we see so many veterans face, the compromising health issues we so many of our aging veterans face, we can and we should do better, particularly as we remember and celebrate you. DJ Hamburger was here at the 9 o'clock service. He did tell me that our local celebration will be in Veterans Park tomorrow at 11. I'm going to go and support him and others as a part of that time, and you're invited to do the same. The other thing here, I thought, gosh, it's the election here, it's Veterans Day, and then there was a giant fire in Southern California. Pray for the folks impacted by the mountain fire. It came awfully close to our old home, and see me in terms of community space. They were impacted, lost a lot of power there. But beyond that, something on the scale of 130 homes were lost in the Camarillo area and in the mountainside there. That feels like a huge number, and we don't quite know how to pray for that kind of impact. If you're looking for just a name, take Carmichael with you as you leave. Will and Jen Carmichael are friends of mine from the theater community. They have 2 young boys, and they lost their home in the fire. Everybody's safe, everybody's healthy. They were able to save some things, but they sure did lose a lot. So if you're looking for a story to place with your prayers, remember Will and Jen. And so we gather on a morning like today to do good work together and to lean into God's word and look for a word of hope today. But to get there, I need to go to the throne in a word of prayer to settle us in. So if you'd indulge me for a minute, let's pray. Holy One, we come before you in a season of life, and we ask that you're present to us. We'd ask that you meet us this morning. We give you thanks for our vets, for their witness to the power of country and community. We pray for their health, for their present, and for their future. We ask, O God, that you are present to each this morning, each of us, but especially me. May your Spirit settle us in. May it move among us. May we know your grace and your strength. May we be able to give weight to each word and wings to each hope. May we offer healing and grace, mercy and forgiveness, compassion and challenge. Spirit, move us and move among us, that we might be able to say that the words of my hearts, the words of my mouth, the meditations of all of our hearts, that they were found to be acceptable in your sight. O Lord, who is our strength and the source of all salvation. Amen. So we come to the final Sunday, 5 of 5 in our Do Unto Others campaign and the conversation about choosing kindness in our election process. And our election done happened, and as Max Lindsay reminds us, we know who our future president is, and we continue to pray for President Trump and a peaceful transition to power, knowing what we now know. But as we gather here today, as we do this good work on the final Sunday, we're talking about love. We've come through a season where we talked about compassion, we heard from our kids about kindness, we talked about respect last week, and here we have the opportunity to talk about the long and the short of the gospel rooted in the idea of love. And one of the things that I feel compelled to ask, I certainly wrestled with it this week, is does the outcome of Tuesday change anything about the vision of our campaign? Let me ask that again. Does the outcome of Tuesday change anything about the vision of our Do Unto Others, Choose Kindness, Be Here for Good campaign? The other way to maybe ask it and to put you more on the spot is, did the outcome on Tuesday affect your ability to live into that vision, hope, and call? Is it somehow harder to love the other, to hear them, to see them? Does the outcome change the vision? Well, there are a couple of things that I'm wired in that regard. One is that I strive for truths, strive for teachings that are true regardless of the context. A gospel outside the context of our lives. There's plenty of times where the context of how we live and how we treat each other needs to shape our understanding of the gospel, but we also need to say things that are right and that are true regardless of the world that surrounds us. And I think the invitation to choose kindness and to do unto others is true regardless of outcomes. Because we often need the reminder that our value and worth is not determined by the outcome. We see that in our professional lives, our kids in their student lives. Think of how defeated your kid feels when they have failed a test or missed a goal or their team lost a game. They tie so much of their personal energy, their happiness, to the outcome of the experience. Well, when we do that on a grand scale and we compound that by millions of people and millions of voices and millions of votes, and there are winners and there are losers, there is a tension there, but our worth is not determined by outcome. I also lean into the work of Jeremiah. The prophet Jeremiah in 37:17 asks a simple question. Is there a word from the Lord for me today? For 25 years, I've been convinced that that is the question that every face that looks back at me in worship centers, be they here or abroad, is the same. People with the need to know, is there a word from the Lord for me today? Does God see me? Does God know my story? Does God care about me? And so we go back to the question, does the outcome change the vision? And my answer is no. And it's Pastor Appreciation Sunday, and I got a cool little statue, so I know by your grace and with your trust, I can do hard things. And so here we are to do good work. No, Tuesday doesn't actually change our common work and our call. We gathered on Tuesday night after a powerful day of communion, and there was this great shot that our district superintendent took of the communion elements with framed behind it, our do unto others as you would have them do unto you text on the wall. This powerful vision that the golden rule is still at our heart. We want to treat people with compassion, respect, with justice, with love. Help them to know that they are included and welcomed at the table of God, because those are the exact same things that we long for or have longed for at some point in our lives. So in some ways, if your question this morning is, did Andy have the other sermon ready for a different election result? The answer is no. Because at the heart of who we are called to be a people of love. And as a people of love, we have to make space for vulnerability. So I want to share and confess that last week brings a lot of powerful emotions to the table. There's the grief of those who feel as if they have lost something. that their voice and their vote wasn't either enough or didn't count because their candidate, be it local or in a big way in the national election, didn't win. And in the same way, when I coached my kids to not assign all of their happiness, joy, and self-worth to the outcomes of sporting events, so too must we try on the possibility that that has to be the case for events like elections. But we acknowledge the grief, that there is loss, that there is heartache. We acknowledge that there's celebration, jubilance, when a candidate chosen and preferred by you wins. It's an opportunity for them to say, I embrace the civic opportunity and responsibility to serve the people of this country. I don't see it as a mandate from one side or the other, wasn't 4 years ago, isn't now, to be performative on my behalf as to how we live the gospel truth. But rather, I do see, as someone who emphasizes free will and the power of choice and consequence and responsibility, I see responsibility in the midst of victory. I said a couple of weeks ago that both sides had a platform rooted in fear. If you elect this person, the country's going down the toilet. If you elect this person, the country is going to shambles. And there were ads and barbs and arrows thrown back and forth and back and forth. Well, now our country has made a decision and we have the opportunity to say to our victors, there is a responsibility to live into the hope and the promise that more than half of our country believed in. That you provide the right kinds of answers to some of the problems that face us. But no matter what happens, because our political process is about this back and forth and this barbs, we still have the reality and sting of division. Maybe in your house, maybe in your classroom, maybe in your office, certainly in the valley as you drive around. We are divided people because we are each given a voice and a vote, and sometimes it breaks our way and sometimes it does not. But church, I can tell you what is true is that we are still and always rooted in love, and that simply has not changed because we have been claimed, as Christine said so aptly, by a God who loves us deeply and refuses to let us go. Now, all that being said, one of the things that struck me is that in the second act of the musical Hamilton, there's a point where Jefferson's moving across the stage. They've gone through the Reynolds pamphlets and the infidelity of Alexander Hamilton and the brokenness and the loss of his son Philip and maybe some of the restoration that might be possible between him and his wife Eliza. There's so much emotional energy in that second act. And Thomas Jefferson says, can we get back to politics? For them in that setting, the politics is a relief to the vent of emotion and pressure. And many of us long for that in our worship lives and in our community lives. And I think that's fair. Lord knows I've noticed the signage around town diminishing. My mailbox has never felt more empty than this last week. My phone doesn't vibrate in my pocket at all hours of the day with different candidates asking for money and campaigning. The world is somehow different just after the elections. But in the way that Thomas Jefferson says, can we get back to politics? By getting back to the gospel, we find ourselves considering who we are because we are rooted in love and Christ's mission in us. But Christ wasn't one who avoided the world. So I want to talk to you about Matthew 22 today because that's ultimately where we're going to wind up, the greatest commandment on the tail end of that whole chapter. But I want you to see how we get to this story of love God and love neighbors. Because Matthew 22 starts with a parable teaching of a banquet. And this banquet is thrown by a king for his son. He's very proud of his son and the marriage that he's going through. And so he sends his messengers out to all of the elite, all of the folks who should be at a celebration like that. And instead, what happens is those messengers are ignored, they're beaten, and in one case, killed. And the king is furious. And so the king says, go out into the streets, invite anybody you find, cast open the doors, and all will be welcome to come in. And so they come and they gather. And these strangers begin to have this feast. And the king enters into the wedding banquet, scans the room, and finds the one person not dressed for a wedding. He says, bind them up. Toss them out. Everybody who listened to Jesus said, whoa, what's that about? And it's a dangerous text in this political season where we might have anxieties and worries about who's in, who's out, who gets bound up, tossed out into the darkness, where there's gnashing of teeth. I confess that, but Jesus tells the story in such a way as to say, just because you're at the banquet, don't presume you know all the ins and outs. You have to make your heart and your life ready for the grace, for the mercy, for the love that God will give you. And if you're not dressed for it, if your heart isn't made right, God forgive you. So the Pharisees and the Sadducees hear this teaching in the Gospel of Matthew, and they get stirred up. The Pharisees take the first swing at it. They said, let's ask a political question. You've made us uncomfortable with dining rooms. Let's talk about taxes. Who should we give our tax to? Because Caesar is not a Jew. And we don't make holy relics and put our image on coins. But Caesar did, and he claimed to be God. How can we faithfully pay a tax in this kind of setting? Now, you all are good readers of the scripture, and you know that Matthew 22, Jesus just puts a stop to it and says, we don't talk about politics in my church. And they all just got quiet and went and said, and no, that's not what he says. He engages them in the conversation. If this is where your heart is, if this is where we need to be, let's be real and let's talk about it. Whose image is on the denarii? Well, it's Caesar's face. Hey, you're absolutely right. So give to Caesar what is Caesar and give to God what is God's. Don't come at me with this anxiety that somehow God cannot work in a system that is imperfect and broken, that God will not be present if you are faithful to God just because you also have to give to Caesar what is Caesar's. Uh-oh. Matthew 22 continues. The Sadducees step up to the plate. Seeing that the Pharisees were thwarted, they decide they want to trip Jesus up with a religious question, a theological one. Jesus, there's a man. He's married to a woman. That woman dies. He marries another woman. That woman dies. He marries another woman. That woman dies. At some point, you have to ask if the man is the problem. Independent of that, their question is this. Their question is this. Who then is he married to in this resurrection you preach about, Jesus? And Jesus says, you got your minds on the wrong thing. You can't see the forest for the trees. And you can't see the resurrection for the hope that it brings. In the resurrection, we don't give to marriage or divorce or worry about the rearing of children. It's an entirely different framework for our relationship with God. And what you want to talk about is this hopeless resurrection that is so mired in legal code that somebody might be excluded because of how they live their life on this side of things. You're missing the point. And the Sadducees feel a sting and they go back over here. And then we get to today's text. And I wanted to give you that because today's text starts in that spot. Matthew 22 reads in this way. Hearing that Jesus had silenced the Sadducees. So again, it's like baseball. Somebody strikes out, the next guy comes up out of the batter's box. Hearing that Jesus had silenced the Sadducees, the Pharisees got together. One of them, an expert in the law, tested Jesus with this question. Teacher, what is the greatest commandment in the law? And Jesus replied, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. The law and the prophets hang on these two commandments. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Well, the simple truth is in these two great and secondary commandments, we have the fullness of our understanding of who we are meant to be in love. For every legal code that describes how we ought to treat one another, how we ought to treat how we eat, where we live, what we do, all of these things are intended to be a lens through which we might be more capably able to love God or to love our neighbor. This is the lens that's lifted up, that's instructing us on the fullness of what we are meant to do. This greatest and second commandment that invites us to consider how we might love God fully in our vertical relationship, as if we always imagine God up there and out there somewhere. But it helps me in the image of the cross to think of God in a vertical relationship and others in this horizontal plane, as if we live out the cross faithfully. You need to know that your Bible has for you a radical call to love. It jumps off the page, and at the time of Jesus and in the time of Paul, it was countercultural. And so if you find yourself this morning feeling like the election results, be they an honor to you or a disappointment to you, have somehow shifted the axis of a national identity or a corporate identity off of the expectations of who God is, know that God loved the world and sent Christ in the midst of division and sent him as a counter to that culture. To say love's going to offer a different way to go, and you need to love God fully with your heart, your mind, and your soul. And you need to love your neighbor as you love yourself. There is this relationship in the language between fullness and portion. Love God with your full being, heart, mind, and soul, and offer a portion of that to the world. Your neighbor as you love yourself. And you can't sacrifice one for the other and say, well, I'm going to love the people with all my heart, mind, and soul and try and love God as I love myself. The inverse does not hold true. The implied instruction in the greatest commandments is this: never substitute the love of others for the fullness of the love of God. And you can put whatever you want in the first half of that sentence. Never substitute the love of political party for the fullness of love of God. Never substitute your frustration with your neighbors for the fullness of the love of God. Never substitute a political candidate or a political position for the fullness of the love of God. We are called first to love the Lord our God with our heart, our mind, our soul, and to portion that out to our neighbors who we love as ourselves. That's how you get to this place that by the middle of the next chapter in Matthew, just to give you a window into what's going on here, is that Jesus will stand over Jerusalem just before he's about to enter in again. And as he looks down over the city, he says, "Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem." And he lifts up this heartbreaking anecdote of this being both the city of God, but also the place that kills God's prophets and turns its back on God's edicts. And what does Jesus say in Matthew 24? Well, when he looks at a broken city that's divided by its politics and its theological positions, he said, "I'd just love to gather you in like a mother hen, and I'd like to hold you as my common chicks together and let you know love and safety, if but for one day." Because the Bible has a radical call to love in it. A reminder that you and I are created and equipped to love God and to love neighbor. And that call to love, that burning desire within each to be in relationship with our Creator and with our fellow creation, is so fundamental to who we are that we need to appreciate that we are called to love God and to love our neighbor, full stop. Because if we start to get into the weeds with the even whens of life, we miss the point. You're called to love God and to love neighbor. Even when the election didn't go my way, even then. Even when my next door neighbor voted different than me, even then. Even when someone in my house votes different than me, even then. Even when somebody on social media says something nasty about me or posts a meme that upsets me, ooh, even then. We are called to love God and our neighbor, full stop. In these is the whole of the pattern of life, the law and the prophets, and who we are called and equipped to be. It is an act of discipleship. Love is a discipline that we put into action, and it is something that we do to grow in Christ. Because this is a place that has affirmed, it is one of the things that we know to be true, that God's love changes everything. Now, in that expression is not the conviction that God's love makes it exactly the way I want to be. But God's love is changing me. God's love is equipping me. God's love is making a message of hope and peace, of hospitality and rich and abundant love, all the more real every day in and through me. As we close, I want to just talk a little bit about stewardship. You'll hear a little bit from Camille about it as well in a moment. So this is a season in life. It's a season in every church's life where they're looking ahead to what comes next in the coming year. Check your mailboxes. I sent you a letter with a stewardship card in it, with a pledge card in it that outlines our vision and thanks you for your work in this last year. You might have been a little bit shy about checking your mailbox for a while. Go and check it now. Hopefully it's there. In it, I talk about the idea of the harvest of the heart, that what God is doing is stirring the soil of the people of God such that we might draw in a harvest of hearts and lives, that next year might be an opportunity for us to grow, yes, in numbers, but beyond that, in capacity to be in ministry to the world. It names our common need. Family of faith, know this, as your household expenses continue to rise, so too those of the house of God. And we need your support in that. The stewardship opportunity and the stewardship letter reminds us that generosity towards God is something that is missional and is expressive. We ask you not just to consider what you might be giving to Valencia United Methodist Church in the coming year, but how you, yes, you might respond to God's gifts and generosity in your story and express that as a gift back to God as received here. One last piece of exegesis, and then I'll pray and move us forward. Matthew does something interesting with the greatest commandment. So Mark's version of it, which is the oldest version of it from chapter 12, says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, your soul, your mind, and there's a fourth component, your strength. And it's actually more faithful to Deuteronomy to say that. Because Deuteronomy, where that particular passage emerges from, talks about loving God with your soul, with your strength, and with your heart. It is, in fact, in the Gospel of Mark where you have the addition of mind, and I don't quite know why Matthew decided to pull strength from that. I'll get that answer in eternity when I sit down with him for some Starbucks. But strength is about capacity. We talk about it that way. The strength that you have to do something or to engage something or to be something. Strength is about activity. And our stewardship and our generosity is about loving with strength, using what we have and what we can do to make a difference in the world. At the end of the day, the mission is the same. The sermon is the same. Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. Treat people with equity, with kindness, and with love. Choose kindness as a way of life, even when it's hard to do so, because that's the gospel call. Let's pray. Gracious and holy God, we give you thanks for this day and all the days you grant us in this, your creation. Walk with us, we pray, through seasons of life, but into new opportunities in the days, the weeks, and the year to come. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.